Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Luis Alberto Moreno, President of the InterAmerican Development Bank, Ray Washburne, President and CEO of the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, and our moderator, Liz Schrayer, President and CEO of the U.S. Global Leadership Coalition.
Well, hello, everyone. That was very exciting, and it was a great setup for our conversation right now. So this conversation is going to dig a little deeper into public-private partnerships, development finance, with a special focus on what Ivanka just was talking about, Latin America. So this, we are lucky to have Ray and Luis to help us figure out this conversation. So I'm going to jump right in, and I'm going to start with you, Ray. As Ray knows, I run a coalition. A lot of our board members are actually in the audience, U.S. Global Leadership Coalition, that brings together businesses and NGOs from Walmart to Save the Children. And we advocate for global development, for diplomacy, everything from USAID, MCC, Peace Corps, multilateral banks. And over the years, we happen to notice that development finance has been underutilized. Mm-hmm. And we took our breath away when the administration originally zeroed out OPIC. But the stars have aligned, and some great things are about to happen this week. We are hopeful, and a lot of it is because of you. We have an administration has called for doubling the finance capacity of OPIC. Right. We have Congress, bipartisan effort, that is calling for a new development finance corporation. Mm-hmm. And if this week happens as the way we think it's about to unfold, with joining on to the an unusual bill, we're going to see the Build Act pass that's going to bring a new development finance institution corporation. So Ray, tell us, if all goes well and the Build Act passes, what is it going to mean to economic development, particularly in Latin America? Finance, and what is it going to mean to the return on investment for American taxpayers?
Sure. Well, thank you. So the Build Act was introduced on Friday evening. The House will vote on it on Wednesday, and then hopefully the Senate Thursday or Friday. So hopefully by the end of this week, we have a new development agency. It'll be renamed from OPIC, which has always gotten very confused, as you can imagine, to the United States International Development Finance Institution. And the abilities it gives us is, in the past, OPIC has purely been a debt financial institution, and this will give us the ability to put equity into projects, as well as being able to do feasibility studies. In the past, OPIC has really had to sit back and take calls from people on projects to finance, and this will give us the ability to actually go out in areas like Latin America, and we'll hear of themes at, let's say, ports or other infrastructure projects. But in the past, we've had to just wait and have someone bring them to us. This way, we can actually go out and fund studies to be done. OPIC currently is a $29 billion agency. We get doubled to $60 billion, and it's an exciting time to be at OPIC. As many of you know, we're a profit-making venture. Last year, we made $260 million in profit. And so when I came into office a little over a year ago, I just went to the White House and to the Hill, and OPIC was up for elimination. I said, look, OPIC is really a tool of national security and our foreign policy. Yeah. And once that was understood, then a lot of momentum got behind taking OPIC to where we are today. When I came in, we had 6 projects in Latin America. Today we have 89. We've done everything for geothermal projects in Honduras to, we've got coffee plantations in Guatemala. So we're full spectrum lender.
Great. So, Luis, let me ask you about the region you cover, mm-hmm. and specifically on the Northern Triangle. I focused a few months ago, was watching, obviously, the border crisis and debate that was going on, and I actually wrote an op-ed taking a look at not just the crisis going on, but actually the root causes of what causes a mother, a father to migrate, leave, and flee their home to go to something that's really unknown. And I took a look at our own foreign aid, bilateral aid. We spend 2% of our 1% on foreign aid to Central America and Mexico. And then I looked at an op-ed you wrote, and you started to talk about the migration into the region that is causing even more chaos, more difficult. And you talked about we need a coordinated finance response to the region. Talk to us about some of the finance gaps and opportunities that we should be having from the International American Development Bank side. What can we do to create more economic sustainability, scale, impact?
Well, thank you very much, Liz. And let me begin by really congratulating you and, of course, Ray for doing something that I've always advocated in the U.S. government when one looks at other countries and the way they deploy their foreign aid. And more foreign aid is going in the way that is less deficit-making mm-hmm. and more profit-making, with a sense of having, in essence, patient capital, the capacity to mobilize other sources. And this is what I think OPIC is going to be able to do now, with the capacity to leverage over $80 trillion that is sitting in a lot of asset managers, hedge funds, you name it. So I think this is huge news. I hope we can celebrate at the end of the week, because I think this will be transformational for the United States. Having said that, let me just step back for a minute. The Northern Triangle, which is basically Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, comprise about 30 million people. And if you look at any indicator in terms of informal labor markets, in terms of poverty, in terms of literacy rates, access to health, by comparison to the rest of Latin America, these are perhaps some of the worst indicators. So the U.S. economy, as we all know, is very strong. And the fact that you're getting many of the people coming into this country from these three countries is largely because they are looking for a different economic opportunity. So as you mentioned, the question is, how do we really create development in those countries? And there's a whole host of areas that one can work in. I think there is a case to be made in how you integrate better the value chains that are, say, from NAFTA, from Mexico into the United States, that eventually some, as you had 20 plus years ago, and Ray knows this well because he's a Texan, he's there in the border, but you remember the maquilas. Mm-hmm. The maquilas went to China because of labor costs. Well, equally, today those labor costs have converged. But there is a case to be made that you could perhaps integrate some of that labor as long as people stay in those countries. But the questions that Ray was mentioning in terms of the basic infrastructure, ports, airports, access to energy, some of the highest costs of energy are precisely in those countries. Now, in terms of the larger question, and this is new to Latin America, is this notion that all of a sudden we're getting a lot of economic migrants for a variety of reasons. Some that we just mentioned in the Northern Triangle. Many of the internal problems in Nicaragua today are displacing people, especially to Costa Rica and into Panama. And the problems of Venezuela, which is the biggest humanitarian crisis we've ever had, right, has meant that just in the last 2.5 years, the numbers of Venezuelans leaving Venezuela is larger than the people that came from the Middle East, especially Syrians, into Europe. The difference being that if you compare income per capita in the countries in Europe as those in South America, those in Europe are 3 times as much, therefore the absorption capacity of those migrants is so much higher. And therefore, I believe that it is time to really look hard and see how we can create a fund that basically helps governments deliver some of the basic services, but equally communities, and take some of the lessons that we've seen from Syrians going, say, for instance, into Lebanon and into especially Jordan. So that also means doing many of the things that you have been doing, which is how to mobilize the private sector and benefit those companies, say a Nike supplier who is producing tennis shoes that can bring into their labor force migrants who came from Venezuela or any one of these countries and then source back into the United States. So we need, early childhood education, which is fundamental. You need to build the economic opportunity such that these migrants basically have an opportunity and they will remain in many of these countries. Right. So that's the kind of challenge that we have today, and it's entirely new to Latin America.
So let me ask Ray a question. As Luis is describing this leveraging of the private sector, the United States isn't the only player out there. There are competition. We're seeing it all over the world. We're seeing it, you and I have talked about seeing it in Africa, but we're seeing it in Latin America alone. One of the big players is China out there. Their One Belt, One Road initiative, assuming they fund it as well as they say, it's going to be 7 times that of the Marshall Plan. They're doubling their diplomacy budget. So talk about how you see that competition out there, how the two of you are working together, what initiatives you're taking, and how, like the Build Act, other programs that you're doing are really taking on the competition so that America's private sector, how the public is helping, make a difference for our own economic interests.
Well, politically, the Chinese are all over Latin America. Yep. They've recently, El Salvador switched from Taiwan to China, and we pulled our ambassador back from El Salvador. I'm actually going down there next week, as well as Panama and Colombia. We are very active in those areas, but the Chinese are, the Belt and Road, most people think of it as kind of a China to through Europe yep. road. It's really a worldwide road. Mm-hmm. And one of the key points for them is Panama and the trade routes so they can control logistics. And so in Panama, a lot of the offloading facilities are controlled by Chinese companies. And from the United States, free trade, really worldwide trade perspective, the Chinese are very quietly buying up these assets. And so one thing we're actively looking at is helping to fund the redevelopment of ports in countries like Colombia and El Salvador and throughout the Honduras and countries throughout Latin America, because the Chinese have gotten there. The United States wasn't engaged in Latin America for the last decade, and we're changing that
Great.
Today.
Luis, you have been one of the real innovative thinkers around the billions to trillions efforts. If we're going to get to the sustainable development goals, this kind of idea of leveraging private sector engagement. So give us an example of what you are seeing that's actually working on the ground, how, whether it's OPIC, the International American Development Bank, are working together to really bring sustainability and scale to some of these difficult spots in Latin America.
Well, one very important thing to understand is that collectively, we typically take an infrastructure project, we never take more than 30% of the total value of the project. And if you're an insurance company, if you're an asset manager looking for long-term kind of investment that you can mitigate a number of risks, one of the issues, and this is something we've been working with Ray, is that if we provide a guarantee out of our balance sheet, it accounts as a loan. If you get an off-balance sheet type of vehicle, you can then turn that into a guarantee that can mobilize from $1 that you put off your balance sheet, say, to $10. And where are those $10 going to come? They're going to come from a variety of areas. They can be insurance companies, they can be asset managers, they can be banks. And so the way we have begun to shift our way of thinking, these institutions typically have been historically very insular. Yeah. So you got to think as kind of like any commercial bank, that what they do is syndications. There's a big department of people doing syndications. Well, we gotta do the same. And we gotta think that the incentives to our staff are such that for every dollar that we put into a project, we can at least get $3-5 more that are coming from third parties. And that means that you gotta open the house and embrace all these other actors to begin to think that you give people varieties of risk. And you can layer a project with varieties of risk. And there's people who will always do that. Some will, and if you start to do that, some will take some of the foreign exchange risks, which you can offload, and you can offload in the markets. And these are the kinds of things we are doing, especially in those countries that, of course, are investment grade. It becomes more difficult in countries that are not investment grade. And this is where we have to create hybrid type of mechanisms. But I think this is the future to address a fundamental issue that Ray was just mentioning. The reality is that the scale of need is so big that even since Addis Ababa, when it was this big development conference in thinking of how do you go from billions to trillions, this is going to be the only way. And this is how we're going to be able to close many of the gaps that are out there on the Millennium Sustainable Development Goals.
So Luis and Ray, let me ask you one last question, which is picking up on something that Ivanka talked about, women economic empowerment. It's been a priority for both of you. Ray, you have OPIC 2X. You have an initiative. You launched it multiple places, but particularly in Latin America. Mm-hmm. So tell us about the initiative, and why specifically did you go down to Peru and make a big focus there?
Well, that was the Summer of the Americas, a big audience.
Yeah.
In the last year, we've committed over $1 billion to projects, women-owned businesses and enterprises in Latin America alone. And so the idea is, you know, women have been underserved in the capital markets. They're the bedrock of the communities. And so going into projects that even help, whether it's water or energy, things to help get the economy going. But one thing we've done is we go to local banks in a lot of these countries, we give them what's called SME loans, small, mm-hmm. medium-sized enterprises, and then have them break them down to smaller micro loans to help women businesses accelerate. First loan I did in September last year was to a bank in Costa Rica. We put $50 million in. The requirement was 20% of the loans had to go to women-owned businesses. And since then, we've grown that to over $1 billion of projects throughout Latin America and Central America.
Fantastic. Luis?
Well, actually, you know, when you look at this whole space, as Ray correctly says, there is no area that can provide for more growth into our economies than empowering women and getting them into business. And the typical failure that you see around many of these businesses is a gap of financing. Mm-hmm. So the question is how to do it. You can do it through a variety of ways. Look at the value chains. For instance, how the supplier chain through mezzanine type financing, through equity, this is something that OPIC and IDB were currently working on, and hopefully we can launch it around the W20 in Argentina, mm-hmm. later this year, which is a fund that we will provide the debt element of that up to 30%, and we hope to raise in the market the 70% of equity that then can in turn go to many of these women entrepreneurs, and you can provide not only lending, but equally equity. And you can do it in a way where you have patient equity, where you don't have to have very high returns, but on the contrary, structure it in such a way that, especially for those businesses where you can see that there's growth. And the story about women entrepreneurs is that they're best credit risk that you can find. And everybody will tell you that, not only in Latin America, but around the world.
I'll agree with that. Let
me point out one thing on that too, is when you go into these local markets, the interest rates are so high, they're 15, yeah. 18, 20% in very short-term loans. No one can ever get any traction because you're just paying interest. OPIC goes in, we loan money at 5%. And so by bringing the borrowing costs down to a reasonable level and giving reasonable term on loans, that's helping to accelerate this development too.
So 30 seconds. Yep. If we were sitting here 5 years from now and we look back and said, that development finance, mm-hmm. corporation made a difference. The new financial blending that, Louise, you're talking about made a difference. Years ago, I hosted then-Secretary Bob Gates, who was so invested in development alongside defense. And when I asked him the question, how will we know it was success, he said, it's what we don't see, less conflict. How will we know what each of you gentlemen are talking about is success? Louise, short.
Look, clearly, the success will be the fact that we mobilize millions of people out of poverty through work and through giving them the tools to make it on their own.
Ray?
Yeah, I agree. It's all jobs. If you look at the unemployment rate, especially in the Northern Triangle, of 50%, if we can come back here and drop that by half, we have had a massive success.
Well, good luck to both of you, and we're all going to be right there with you. Everybody,
thank you.
Please thank our two wonderful speakers.
Thank you.